Welcome to my talk. Thank you that you stayed in the room. I'm not Liz, but jumped in for her. My topic is POSIX operators, and I called it POSIX in context. Maybe just before we start, because I have really plenty of stuff. Are you guys more interested in the more basic stuff that I actually deliver on the content, so talk more about context, or are you a little bit more interested on the more esoteric operators? Maybe raise your hand more for the basic stuff first. This looks to me more, I think I don't have to ask. So. All right. That's how I got me started and found a new topic, because I do it for quite some years. But let's drop that, because as you know, operators are for Perl really important. Not only Perl 5, even more Perl 6 is an operator-oriented language. Yeah, it's not even a term invented by me. And that's why I want to first talk some things about operators in general. It may be sound that I will go a little bit off-road, but you will see it's not really. Yeah? Operators are like little pictograms. You know, as you maybe see, if you see that in one nice church in Sofia or in Kiev, you could see that. You maybe don't know the name of the angel in particular, but you know what it is about, and you see it in just split of a second. Yeah, even if there are millions of pixels, you can recognize what it is. Yeah, and that is because you have in the back of your eyes massive parallel hardware for edge detection. Yeah, called also retina, something he doesn't told you, or he couldn't have to sell me not quite retina display. Of course, with a little bit of adding of the visual cortex, and that's necessary because the rational mind is about the slowest part of your consciousness at all. There are about 12 million information every minute you process, and consciously, in the rational mind, you process about 40. So everything which you can source out to the non-rational is a big win. You know, that's why a lot of processing goes on before it even hits the eye, and you're used to it for the good. Yeah, we use it all the time for quick orientation, use empty lines, indentation, decorative comments. Yeah, nothing special about it. You do it every day because there's a level behind it I want to talk about. One of the things I didn't talk about is the emotional brain, because there's yet another layer of processing that goes on before even the information hits your mind. Yeah, and if you like, listen to Antonio Damasio, one of the leading neurolinguists, emotions are not feelings. We have on the one side the feelings, which are more based on the physical reactions of the body. And then you have emotions which you maybe can feel here, which are more by associations done by your brain. Yeah. In fact, Damasio says emotions is how your brain deal with huge data quantities. Yeah. So he has for everything a little category, and it does it by association. Yeah. Of course, our values and judgment comes for it, but also memories. This the consequence of that means that all the smart guys who mean we have to stay rational, no, don't get any emotional, that they also vote for Alzheimer, because without a little bit of emotion, there's not even remembering, yes, and that's why there's even another angle to look at. Tim Todi is that if you actually respect how emotions are wired, we have less emotional stress and much higher productivity. So that even Perl should make sense for people who have like the dollar signs in their eyes. Yeah, it's one of the things where it isn't really applied is maybe in Java, where the plus sign is overloaded, so it can concatenate strings, or you can die plus. And in order to have to figure out which it is, you have to look, you have to search. So your precious cycle, you have only one and a half, every you have just a rational thought every 1.5 seconds were wasted to figuring it out. Yeah? We in Perl 6 are much smarter about it. If you see a plus sign, it's always about numbers and addition and such stuff. Yeah, which is much more brain-friendly, saves you a lot of cycles. Yeah, another thing is things in general we call topicalizer, like, for instance, the class command. For instance, if you open a file and you see on the head class, you know what it's about. There will be methods, there will be attributes, you know what it's about. You don't have to figure out, you don't have to look for is a like in Perl 5, and like your context is set. Yeah, that's all done by emotion. But there is even a deeper level, and don't worry, then I will stop about it. I want to present you Jill Bolter. She was a neuroanatomist, which actually had a stroke on her left brain side and could experience all the interesting things mystics were talking about since centuries. Yeah, and she put our attention on a very important dichotomy that we have on the left brain, which thinks in sequence, also enables language, that our abilities to even speak or hear or write language is done by the left brain. I mean, that's not entirely true, because we know of other incidents that it can be rebuilt by other parts of the of brain when it's damaged, but it's a good first approximation. And the other part, the right brain, which works in parallel, is good to see the whole pictures. So when we have complex software systems, we won't also use the right brain. This is the part where my speaker before said it has also a little bit of art, because we have to leave the part who enables us for language to do grok our whole software system at once. Yeah, this is the one who works more graphical. And actually, this is where all the crazy operators, which are come to the end of my talk, get in very handy, is because it enhances our understanding from more the complex systems. And that's not just we in Perl 6. This, for instance, here we have James Gates, a rather known physicist, who paints this adinkras, which this one graphic represents a whole set of equations. A physical equation about supersymmetry, about and all the colors and the dots are about the variables and certain operations, and they condensed all the knowledge of this complicated physics in this graphic, and were that's why able to find new findings which other people didn't found in 30, 40 years. Even Stephen Wolfram's book, A New Kind of Science, taps into that, who goes also into massive parallelism and into graphics and how it can enhance our understanding from computability. I just want to take you back that it can utilizing our right brain and our graphical understanding can help us much understand much more in one spot, and that operators are a great segue into that, and that is. And that's maybe one of the reasons we have these operators, yeah. And because they are so graphical, like they lead us more directly in that part of the brain which already handles graphics. All right, don't worry. This end of my sermon. Now it's about syntax. Yeah, because when you see in the synopsis, there it is right there. Perl 6 is a context-sensitive language. And how is it done in Perl 5? With want array, yes? but we know how it works, but we have no want array in PL 6 anymore. Even the whole notion that we have context that is wanted, and depending on that we return different value, this is gone. Things operate in PL 6 very differently, because we have contexts which are in truth data types, which are in truth classes. Yeah, it's everything organized in classes, yeah, like num, string, array, hash, as you name it. You could figure it out. So when you have a little bit of code, you could write it also so, because we have optional types now. Like I said, there are classes. And if you want to convert it, of course, you don't want to do it the Java ways. In fact, if I should be honest, we have such method like to string, but we hide it. We want to have it more Perlish, more fun. Yeah. In Perl 5, we had this maybe this goatsy operator, which goes closest to that, which I want to explain you. In not really fun way. Yeah, maybe for a minute, but not for coding. If yeah, you know the Perl secret op documentation. If you want to get a real list context, I should look more like this, I think, because you know what the at sign means, you could figure it out, and that's actually how it works in Perl 6. Yeah, that is maybe dereferencing was in Perl 5, but this is how we do it in Perl 6, and of course we know the sigils, we know what they do. Sigils, by the way, are now invariant, which means and hash has always a percent at the front, even if I want just one value, but more native Perl 6 is more of that. And we have two or three more. Yeah? And you can, of course, use the short version or even the long version, which does the same. Yeah? Braces are optional, and you can even have the flat context like in Perl 5. You just spell it flat. I think that's pretty much self-explanatory. This is rather nice if you have a variable, and this variable is a name of a package, and then you want to have like the content of a package, use it as a package. So you dereference it as a package name. I already used it once. It's very helpful. Yeah. But maybe that there are some new contexts which came to, because something like a list context we already have in Perl 5. But these are really new, the string, numeric, and the Boolean context. And of course, the numeric and Boolean, you can have the opposite too. Yeah? For instance, you can put it in front of a list, and if you make the tilde, you have the content, like all the string content in concatenated. Plus means the number of elements. Yeah, we have no more length. And the question mark asks me if there's anything in the list, actually. Yeah. Okay. Let's maybe start with the bool context. It looks easy, no? Yes or no? What could be possibly be hard about that? Yeah. no, actually, that is about the Boolean context. These others also use some sort of logic, and because logic is about yes or no, I squeeze them in and wonder, look, hey, it's difficult. No. Actually, the question mark forces the Boolean context. So if I do that, I, of course, get a true because I have something in the variable. Can't get easier than that. Yeah, but of course, in truth, there is bool true, but say itself forces the string context. Bool true in string context is true. Yeah, so we have all the time these context conversions in Perl 6, and that is how things go. Yeah, yeah. If you do negation, it would be false because there is something in it. Yeah. And we have also the so, like, is it so? Yes. But like we know it already from Perl 5, if you use the words, then it has low precedence, no? If you use the or. But if I take the operator or, like the lines, it has higher precedence. So actually, yeah, and the negation of so is not. That's E, by the way, yeah, the Euler number. We have that at constant. So if I do, for instance, that, yeah, it is 2. Yeah? Sure, because this question mark has higher precedence. There is something in it, so it is true. Because we have a plus, it is numeric context. In numeric context, this is true 1 again, as we know it. In numeric context, true is 1, as we know it from Perl 5. 1 plus 1 is 2. Of course, I don't need to say that. What maybe come out of that? Any idea? What? Yes, of course, it's true. Because 45 and 1 are 46, and this is true. Because, like I said, the so has low precedence. If you're not sure, make your braces and you will see. Yeah. And exactly that's how if, unless, while, until work too. They force the Boolean context, yeah, like so did too. All right, first row done. Hey, yeah, slowly eating through the morning. Next thing, what is that? We already figured out what the question mark is. It converts to Boolean context. I think you have a slightly idea what this might be, and if you combine it, you get the idea. So if you had, this talk was lastly held in Czech, less means would, but doesn't need to bother you. When I ask you that, what could be the result? You don't count, you know. You know, anyway. Any idea what could be the result? Of course, true, because it is an or, and one of the two is true, so it is true. Yeah, that's a little bit harder. Actually, I had to look up for it to figure that out. But it's true also, because XOR can also be only true if one of the two is true, yeah? As we know. Okay, so you've seen what they do. They convert both values on both sides to Boolean context, and then do the logic on it. Yeah? Then you maybe ask, then what the heck are doing they now. That's a funny thing called junction. If you put that in a variable, then actually that what is staying here is in a variable. You still preserved this old logical construct. And that's actually useful to make some nice if statements or to combine some logics. It makes your code actually much clearer. Yeah. Means wild is also less. It's in German. Yeah. So we have. You could write 1 or 0 or 1 or 3, which can be also written that way. If you have the and, which means all this and this and this. This means all have to be true to get a true. Or if you have XOR, only one, just one has to be evaluated to true to get a true out of it. Yeah. This is how SmartMatch uses that. This is actually false because we don't have two in any combination, but this would be true. But even if you make equality, because this one gets compared with zero, which is of course false, the one is compared with one, which is of course true. The one compared with 3 is again false, but if you have a junctive combination of them with like an or, it is just one has to be true and the combination is true. So if I put it in an if statement, no, if 0, 1, or 3, and it one is no, like this, and you don't, it don't blows up like we have in Perl 5. No? Something like that works under the hood. Yeah? And we have these. And of course, these I don't think I explained because they work exactly as you would expect from Perl 5. Yeah? We don't have time, we don't have time. So, yeah, defined or, we know it, we have it since 5.10. We know that very well. Maybe that will bit, ignite a little head scratching, but that is actually what's going on within Xor. Yeah. So the Xor like makes sure you get a negative result if possible. Yeah, very optimistic view of the world. And I've written it that way because you don't get an else with an unless. I couldn't write here unless and then else. Yeah, it's forbidden in Perl 6. All right. Oh shit. No, so we got this one. I forgot to translate. Yeah, then we have, of course, the numerical. Give me the minimum of two or the min-max of two. Actually, you can min-max you get from a list, but not min-max. I don't understand why, but we can fix that later. And we, of course, we have the flip-flop operator. That was dot-dot and dot-dot-dot in Perl 5 in list context, something very easy to overlook. You have something, a dot-dot, and then you look closer into and see, oh, shit, there's a... No, can't happen in Perl 6 because we are written in the other way. And even in, it's unambiguous and also Huffman coding wise optimized. Yeah, it's used mostly in that way. I think you remember. Yeah, and there's the ternary left because, of course, double column we now use for different things, your usual ternary. And it has the same common thing, and that's why it is good to remember that in the ternary actually returns one of the two values depending on this first expression unchanged. And that's also how these all work, also these four. So you, it's like good to remember. So when you see like an operator doubling, like it said, is it forces no context on it. No? The shorter ones all these combines forced context, but if you're two times the same symbol after each other, then it doesn't force any context on the value. Yeah, of course, ternary up, you know it, your pros. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Next context. It's a numeric. Of course, I don't have to teach you math. You already knew that. We have now real rationals, which preserve the denominator and the other number. Modulo as we know it. The only new thing is not this is called not mod mod, but it is just says me if there is a remainder, meaning it says me if it is divisible. And here it is false because we have a remainder. Yeah? This is the same thing as I explained you before, just in numeric context. So you put all the values on the left on the right side of this infix operator in numeric context, and then do the logic, which means that is a bit logic we know. It was previously that. And this is your bit shifting, of course. Yeah? What formerly was that. And that's about it. Not really that hard. Have I something forgotten? Of course not. Because these don't change the context. Yeah? There's something completely different. It's like Monty Python, or something completely different. Because if we make comparisons, we need for that ordered sets. Yeah, we have a set, and we have something values before and something after, and we have a generic mechanism in Perl 6, therefore. And this plus plus and this minus minus just gives you the next. So on numbers, it works like expected. And if you make 5 plus plus, you get a 6. You know, if it would work any other way, people would revolt against Larry, I think. Yeah, but you have maybe other sets, maybe dates. No, you want to have the next day, and you make plus plus, and you get the next day. Yeah, and these are the operators which tell you if something comes after something or before, or they're generic compare, not in numeric context like you know it. Because the ordered sets know the less say more. No, it's like the bool true or bool false I showed you before, which are in numeric context such, and in string context it is less say more. Because this is forces numeric context, this forces string context, no? Greater equal or less equal. No? You know them already from Perl 5, it's just the consequence of them. So you have like a three-way comparison in these contexts. That would be lower than. This is in numeric, this is in string, this is generic, this is greater than, and so on. Like I expect. Equality is also as they expect. This numeric context, this is string context, and that works on every context. And then we have such funny thing like equivalence, which is when I, for instance, would compare these two. Have any guess what that would give you return? Haha, I got you. No, of course not. Because like this is an int and this is a national hash, that are not the same types, and that's why. Of course, if you do it this way, both were converted in numeric context and it works like you would expect. But like EQV also takes into account all the dynamic stuff with rows and which goes on and is much more precise on it. But of course, you don't use it for such trivial stuff. Yeah. All right, we threw the numeric context. Yeah. Oh, yeah, of course, there was a string context, and the dot is gone, you have the tilde, yeah? Like combine Watson. Yeah? And this is the same stuff I explained before. The logic you can also have like char-wise, yeah? Work on that. I didn't find out why you need it, but maybe we will find it one day. Yeah? Smart match not, this is infinite complexity, maybe next time. And of course, you know that that works like in Perl 5.2. Nothing new there. And that is easy. Now more to the very much interesting stuff. We've gone to lists. Yeah. This goes in parts, things Patrick Michaud 2 or 3 years told us about. Because the comma now generates our lists. Yeah? It's not the braces. You can see it with the what method, which every object has, which tells you what type of object it is. If you ask it, what are you? It tells me I am an int. But if I do it that way, they say I am, what is a parcel? I thought now comes list. Yeah, this has something to do. The nice thing about Perl 6 is that we generalize things, that we use one thing over and over again. And if you look rightly to the round braces, it looks a little bit like that what we have in signatures. Yeah, because if we have a method call, we have the method name, and then we have the round braces open, then we have some parameters, round braces closed. So what? And that is actually the same stuff. Because the method or a subroutine could have positional parameters, it could have also name parameters. So we have some sort of container which can have positionals also named, which we call parcel. You know? But of course, if you give it a list and also force it the list context, that's why we got also positionals. If we put it to a hash, we got all the named. Yeah, and it works how you would expect it. Yeah. Or you can force it explicitly. The name parameter with one line and with two lines, just positional, which is exactly how it. The logic behind this is the same actually if you use it in regexes, because you have alternatives in regexes. They're also like if you have one. If they are like in parallel, this or this or this, and if you use two lines, it is meant sequentially, no? Like an array first. There's the first element and the second element, and so on. I like that. Yeah, the sequence operator, this is really, this is magic. I love it. It would be a talk on itself own. No? It merely looks like the YADA operator are completely different things, because we can separate it out in context. No? The YADA operator is just when sub don't allow to be empty, and that's why we have to fill in something, which gives us a warning. No? But the sequence operator, this can give you even backward counting, which no, which ranges can't do. No? If I do that, it's an error. No? A range, always the left side have to be lower than the right side. But the sequence operator can not only do it, does linear, no? You see the double, 1, 2, 4, and so forth, and it figures it out and gives you your array that always doubles. You can also like Fibonacci sequence, because if the first two, then add them and so on. Yeah, Patrick showed it also. It's unbelievable powerful. Yeah, and to strong contrast to that, that gives you really just a parcel. I mean, if you say that, he gives me just that. Yeah? Because it is not a list. Yeah, if you say that. No, still, yeah, as I said, because it doesn't force the list context to braces. So what is it? We ask it for, and this is range. So that is a scalar range object. If we put that scalar range object in list context, then of course it expands into a list. We have a list of 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, up to 9. But in this form, as it stays here, it is just a range. I can do smart match or other type of comparison against. Yeah. No, it's just an object with two values. For instance, if I ask him that, it is true, because 5 lies in between 0 and 9, of course. Yeah. But of course, when we do that, then we get list, because as I showed you in the start, this forces us the list context. Yeah. Or for instance, if you do that, because 4 also forces the list context. Yeah. And you do use it like you're used to in Perl 5, everything works as in Perl 5, and you don't even know what is going on. Yeah? That's good. Yeah? Of course, this way it wouldn't work, because say didn't know on what to call. Dollar underscore works a little bit different. Now it would work. Yeah? Either that dot say, or you put dollar underscore behind the say. All right. And the XX is just to multiply lists. Yeah, this is just our fancy quoting mechanism. Yeah, this is because we have a lot of ways to write QV. The most prominent that what I showed you before. Yeah? And all the X operator, which gives you Cartesian products, which is really nice. Yeah? And that's why my ramblings about this operator and the graphics and the brain, because the X really displays, it's like a pictogram what our Cartesian products are about. Yeah, and you can grasp it very fast. Yeah? And of course, these Cartesian are really Cartesian pairs. So you can, of course, flattening to a list if you like, but you get really a list of pairs, how it should be. Yeah. So you get there are four elements, and of course we have the zip operator, yeah, which takes no, like first to the left, then to the right, back to the left, back to the right, no, like these graphically shows, and also makes pairs, and we can use it if this four loops, we can iterate on two loops in parallel. No? Something I'm really now a little bit angry, because we have in Perl 5.20 this shiny new syntax for hash slices, but we can't nicely iterate on both key value pairs at the same time. No? We have to if each, and with each we lose again the order. It really frustrates me, because it doesn't work so nicely as in Perl 6. Yeah. Did you got what I just said, or was it? Yes, you are, I mean, the normal people. Was not quite understandable what I said. You have two lists, and it put one value from one list in that variable and one value from that list in that variable, because the Z operator makes one long list, first one value here, one there, one here, one there, and every time the next two values goes into these two variables. Yeah, and that is something you can't do with Perl 5, not even with Perl 5.20. And of course, if you want to have these L and write read-write variables, you have to write it this way. And of course, if you make Schwarzian transforms like you used to, you can write them now. Them and these pipe operators show you which way the good stuff flows, or you can flows also this way. Yeah, it like I said, it's a graphical metaphor. Yeah? Or you can even use it in append mode. But this is, by the way, we call pointy sub syntax. All right, we threw that. Now to the real weird stuff. I thought we don't come to it. No, it's not really weird stuff, because actually use it all the time. Yeah? If you make plus zero, it's the normal thing in the world. You use it since C times of K and R. And you actually use the equal sign as a meta operator, for self-assigning. Yeah, and that's the same principles we applied to other things. Of course, we have negation, also often used, but yeah, it's also real P6 code. For instance, that is just a reverse. It reverses the operands. It's sometimes handy to omit braces or other stuff to make more readable code. I didn't use it much. And you have, of course, the S meta operator, which forces to do it in sequentially, but because the stuff I will show you next has a lot of potential to be parallelized, and so there can Perl 6 can secretly behind your back put it on multiple cores, and you don't have to worry. And this way you forbid it to do that. Yeah. Oh, still one slipped. Still check. Yeah. But of course, the X and the Z, which I showed you, they are much more interesting when used as meta operator. The X, like I showed, gives you pairs. And when I now, but when I add now a second operator to it, he will apply it to both values of the pair. And this is maybe the simplest case where I just combine them. That was string combination, as you may remember. That would be a stack trace, because actually this is also a good thing that an A can't be converted to a number. That's not zero in num context. That is really an error, because there's nothing to get a really number from it. But of course, this would be, as you maybe guessed, 3, 4, 6, 8, because the first pair 1 and 3 multiplied are 3. No, 1 and 4, the next pair 2, 3, 6, and 2 times 4 is 8. Yeah. And of course, you can use it, the second operator, all kinds of such operators on these pairs. Yeah. And with, as you guessed it, the same goes with the Z. Yeah. If you do that, they just get combined, or if you multiply it, just 1 times 3 and 2 times 4. Cool. Yeah. Or you can, or you write it this way. Yeah, this is like, you maybe don't want to write it this way, but you could also, this is zip, and this is zip with. Yeah? Because in everything which you write in operator, you can also have a long version when you want to mess with the internals. Yeah? The cross is spelled out this way, and the cross with, that's why. If you use it with another operator as meta op. Yeah? Then you have to reduce, you maybe know from Lisp. No, if you want to add, do the Gauss and add the list from 1 to 100, you do it that way. Or when you check if they are ordered, you get a true. Yeah? And this triangle is one That's a little bit tricky. It just it's like a reduce, but returns a list. It starts like the first value, then uses the first and the second, then the first, second, third, and that's why and makes each time a reduce on them and produce like a list. The functional guys wanted it, they got it. I don't need it. Yeah. And it's no. If you, for instance, if you make a, if you apply it this way, you would get 1, 3 and 6. No, because you have the 1, then you have 1 plus 2 or 3, and 1 plus 2 plus 3 would be the 6. Yeah. All right, hyper. If anyone remembers, doing the hyper operator. This means age. Yeah, the one or two slides I didn't translate from the Czech. Of course, this adds. You don't have to be make it such complicated, but this adds like to every value in that one. No? So you have 18, 22, 35, and it adds to every one, and now you have 19. 23, 36. The important thing is that the arrows have the big side here and the small side on that, which means the vec variables dominates the length. If you would do it differently, that dominates the length and we get just one result. Yeah. That would be, of course, an error because you can't have two bosses. Yeah. But this one will work. This is do what I mean, and if one is not long enough, it gets repeated. Yeah. So the 35 is actually added with one again. No? The 22 is again added with two, and the 35 with one again because 1, 2 was not long enough to match up with this array. Yeah. Of course, a smart match is endless complexity. Not today, and I think. You are now successfully sleeping. Thank you. Are there any questions, comments? Yes?
Sorry, could you please repeat? Yes? Of course, you can concatenate as much as you like. Because when they concatenate it, they're just normal list. You can concatenate on a list as you like. Yeah. And all right, we figured
that out. Good. Maybe one question: Did you find the first part a little bit off going, but at least a little bit interesting? I was just a little bit nervous, so I couldn't bring it over like I wanted, but I find this graphical metaphor much interesting. There are a lot more things I couldn't do it in the 5 minutes because it was about operators, not about how the brain works. But I think the greatest takeaway is really that Perl 6 is all about managing complexity. Have the right object, have the right grammars, how to unify things to make our programs nice, readable, and dense, and manage huge tasks. That is the real thing, problem of the future. Everything else is secondary. And I think that's why a language shouldn't hinder us in our graphical thinking, because that is there where our own understanding of complexity is. Yeah, and if you have such operators which help you a little bit to think in graphic terms, and when you have also operator which stay true in their context, and you don't have to think, is it now concatenates now strings or nums or something like that, that it really helps the way our brain works. Yeah, and even Larry Wall is a linguist, and wind it all up from the linguist side, as programs are not written by programs, but in the end by people with brains, I hope so. And that's why I think the programming languages should be brain friendly, and in my opinion, Perl 6 is so. And yeah, I hope I could make that a little bit clearer. Yes, please. Yeah.
I'm not sure if
Just shout, I hear you.
The question is regarding junctions.
Yes. Do that.
Is there any implication that this will be handled in parallel? Because obviously the CPU is getting more cores and things are starting to work in parallel. And what is really interesting is the context
yes.
Represented in Perl 6 giving any implication to the compiler that's not
yes, that is something I spoke about. Not only the junctions, also the meta operator, like the Lisp, lot of the Lisp stuff, like the Cartesian products and so. There is a lot of room to parallel in the background, and it is one of the explicit design goals of Perl 6 to enable that. I think Perl, if it will work in Perl 5. I'm skeptical about the near future on that, but in Perl 6, there's these parallelizations are one of the last bit which got actually implemented. But it was a design goal from the start to be enabled that, yes.
So it is expected for the context to imply and not have additional prognosis.
No. That's why we have this meta operator with the S to force it not to parallelize. Because in normal cases, it will be parallelized if our core is free. We hope so. And any other question? All right. Then you have more lunchtime. Yeah. I'm actually surprised that I was so fast because I hasted to some parts through, but yeah, missed some jokes. Sorry. Thank you.